For the last 16 months, I've watched Richard and Sophie Hawkes build their experimental tile eco house with my heart in my mouth, wondering if the thing would still be standing each time I visited.
Good to see you. Yeah. Good to see you.
How are you?
Yeah. Very well.
And with its heavy overcoat of soil and gravel evenly spread and in place, what a relief it is to see the building up and in one piece.
And this thing is still standing.
Still standing, still taking the rain.
Now that this earth is banked up against it, it's rearing out of the ground.
Yeah.
Like a magnificent piece of civil engineering, like a bridge or something. Well, what do people here say about it?
We have people stopping in cars going, oh, it's brilliant, I love it. It's so nice to see something different, which is really, you know, really heartening.
I think it's a magnificent-looking building.
The parabolic curvature of the timbrel arch and the way it flares gives the impression that it hasn't so much been built as simply allowed to thrust its way out of the ground. Beneath, Richard's series of wooden boxes nestle under the protective wings of the arch. The interior, though interesting, is not ostentatious.
Oh, this is nice. It's finished. This staircase is lovely, the way that it leads your eye up to the great big ceramic firmament above. Can we go up it?
After you.
Okay. Wow. Gosh. What's it like at night coming up here? What's it like to sleep underneath this great big arch?
I mean, it's beautiful to be up, because at night the lighting on it kind of just makes it glow.
The whole building feels airy. I think it's fantastic.
But now that this is finished, how do you feel?
This is the most satisfying thing I've ever done, without a shadow of a doubt. It's solid, it's a piece of engineering, but yet it looks beautiful.
The vault is undoubtedly spectacular, but using this shape as the internal skin of the building has resulted in some unusual spaces.
This is a guest bedroom, but when you haven't got guests around, this space just feels like a big open hallway and like an upstairs lounge. And when you have guests around, let me just pull this out.
Bathroom. Oh, bathroom wall becomes door.
Door.
It's a wall door.
And then you get an ensuite shower room.
And a toilet. So you can sit on the toilet and have a conversation with somebody in bed.
Yeah,
if you want. If you're in bed, you can't see the wall.
Yeah, I was going to say, because this is not my idea of privacy.
Not all of the upstairs is open plan. Richard and Sophie's bedroom is a very private retreat.
It's good, isn't it?
Yes.
That's kind of good. I'm really not quite sold on the idea of having a bathroom come bedroom, although, yeah. It's kind of, does it work for you?
Absolutely. Well, I always like to have a bath, and Richard always, I always say, oh, come and talk to me while I'm having a bath, and he gets very annoyed by that, so
I used to sit on the toilet while Sophie was having a bath, and I got the bum deal, really, quite literally.
So what's it like, then, in the morning, waking up to this view?
Beautiful. Still getting used to it, to be honest. It's one of those moments that we've been looking forward to in our minds for so long, and now you wake up and we're lying there, and here it is.
Downstairs, the tile vault stretches out on either side of the house. The dining table is tucked under one arm of the arch, whilst Richard's office sits under the other. These are extreme ends of the corridor, off which sit more conventional rooms.
So this is the kitchen.
Are you waiting for a top? No. This is MDF. No,
this is a quartz stone. Composite stone, yeah.
You know, what I find quite interesting is that your kitchen is more like a utility room. It's very Spartan.
It's very simple. It's very functional. I want to be able to cook in it, ultimately, rather than
Far too many cabinets.
And far too much, you know, flash gadgets that actually probably you never use.
Next door to the kitchen, the living room box thrusts out from beneath the arch to terminate in a projecting window.
This window works in a very, very different way up to upstairs, where it's just a wall. And the room is directing you to a view, whereas this is more like a viewing box. You're kind of on three sides, surrounded by glass.
Yeah,
I feel like you're living in the garden without the weather.
Yeah. It's going to be baking hot in here, isn't it?
Well, it could be, but we've got lots of thermal mass in here.
And we'll see if it works, because we've got the monitoring system, which is taking all the data to see how
everything performs. So you've got sensors embedded in the concrete floor?
Yes.
As part of this big living experiment.
It is,
you both undertaken.
This place is so experimental, Cambridge University have sensors embedded all over the house to monitor its performance, to see how the walls and floors store and release heat, how well the revolutionary solar panels generate heat and power, and much more. This place has the capacity to generate energy and sell it back to the grid.
The cost of running this house should be minimal. Every year, you know, I'll get a bit back, hopefully.
Because we're getting paid for the electricity we're producing and we're getting paid for the heat we're producing. So the house is actually giving us an income at the end of the day.
How much do you reckon a year?
£1,800 a year is what we're currently told the house is going to generate as an income, net.
It's going to generate... You're going to get a cheque for £1,800 a year?
Yeah.
Yeah.
From the government.
Instead of paying bills,
yes.
Electricity
yes.
And heating bills?
Yes.
Yes.
I have to just take that backed in because it's... it's not normal.
No.
So I rather like this building. I'm curious, Sophie, whether you think that your husband... I don't want to ask him because he's an architect, he'll just wax on about his own abilities, but whether you think he's delivered and what he's delivered here.
Oh, I think it's absolutely delivered. I think it's created a really great home. He's got carried away in many things and, you know, enthusiasm. When I would say things like, do we really need that? You know, there wasn't a huge amount of negotiation at times.
OK, what were the things which he said, I really want, and you said, do we really need that? What were those items?
There was some discussion over some of the windows, wasn't there?
Well, the lounge window.
The lounge window.
Oh, we might have...
The ones that returns back.
If it's cheaper, we might have to have framed windows. And I said, no, we will have no kitchen, but we will have that window. That was the negotiation.
Well, I have to say, I think most of those, Richard's been right.
With the result that instead of costing £300,000, it costs...
£445,000.
No! That's big!
It's been worth getting carried away because we've got a unique building, and it feels... And a unique building which... Already, having been in here just a few days, really, feels like home.
How much is this building what you wanted?
The idea of building my own house a couple of years ago, maybe more than that, would have actually scared me because I would have been, you know, what ideas do you put into it? What I've seen through going through the process is, blimey, I can do this. The reality is much better than I'd imagined. If I'd stayed in my comfort zone, and then look back at what I'd created, would it inspire me? Don't think so. To look back at this and be proud of the fact I had the courage to do it, I love that. That will give me memories that will last forever.
There was a risk here that the building would have ended up just, well, plain ugly, that, it might have turned into a laboratory rather than a home. But we needn't have worried, because Richard, in the end, did produce a beautiful house, one that is full of surprises, of joys, of delight. It is creative, but it is also risk-taking and groundbreaking. And all those eco-technologies and the building design, I think, have produced a building which is an architectural first in this country. It and the efforts of its maker are heroic.